and welcome to the local campaign. I'm Tammy Sutherland from City News. On October 19th, Canada will elect the 42nd Parliament, and Rogers TV is the only station producing debates of all of Toronto's 25 ridings. For the next hour, you'll hear from the candidates of Spadina, Fort York. And before I introduce the candidates, let's take a closer look now at the riding of Spadina, Fort York.
Spadina-Fort York is a new federal riding that encompasses portions of what was once divided between two other ridings, Trinity-Spadina and Toronto Centre. The riding's southern border is Lake Ontario, including the Toronto Islands. Half its northern border runs along Dundas Street. The other half runs along the Esplanade and Mill Street. The farthest eastern point is the mouth of the Don River, and the western edge snakes up portions of Dufferin Street and Dover Court Road. Neighborhoods within this riding include Trinity Bellwoods, Liberty Village, the southern part of Chinatown, Toronto's financial, fashion, and entertainment districts. The Rogers Centre, David Crombie Park, and the C&E lands are notable landmarks within Spadina Fort York.
Now, as a matter of full disclosure, I myself am a voter in the riding of Spadina-Fort York. And now I will give each candidate 1 minute to make their opening statement. This will be done in the order of most seats by party in the House of Commons. We're going to begin tonight with Sabrina Zuniga from the Conservative Party. Sabrina.
Hi, my name is Sabrina Zuniga. I live in downtown Toronto now for more than 20 years. My husband and I have raised two children in the riding, and I have chaired two school councils. I'm passionate about education, research, and innovation, and that's why I want to represent you in Parliament. The Conservative government recognizes that innovation is critical to Canada's future. That's especially true in our downtown riding of Spadina-Fort York, where a thriving economy can create great opportunities for the people here. That's why it's so important to stick with the Conservative team that has kept Canada's economy strong. We've cut taxes, created jobs, and signed trade agreements, helping Canadian companies sell to the world. The plan has made Canada the envy of the world. I'm asking for you to support me so that I can work for an even stronger economy for downtown Toronto. Thank you.
Thanks, Sabrina. Up next is Olivia Chow from the NDP.
Canada is a magnificent country, but in the last 20 years, we've been working longer hours and getting stuck in traffic even more time. And yet we're not getting ahead as much. That is the track record of the first Liberal government and then the Conservative government. I'm a New Democrat. We're different. We are started by Tommy Douglas, the father of Medicare. We believe that we can take better care of each other, that there shouldn't be such a gap between the rich and the poor, and it's growing, and we're losing the middle class. So today, the NDP will ask the big corporations to pay their fair share so that we can build a better Canada, so we can invest in public transit, invest in children, in affordable housing, in health care, invest in each other. So on October 19th, I ask for your support so we can build a better Canada together.
Thanks, Olivia. Up next is Adam Vaughan from the Liberal Party.
Thank you very much and good evening. My name is Adam Vaughan. I have been a journalist in this city for 20 years, and I left journalism and joined City Council to help try to build a stronger Toronto. And what's clear is that you can't do that without a strong federal partner in Ottawa. And that's why last year I ran in the by-election and was elected to Parliament to fight for cities right across this country. We can build a better country and a fairer country if we build stronger cities. We can build a better country by investing in transit and housing. We can build a fairer country by making sure we don't leave people behind. We can target tax cuts to those people that are struggling, young families and seniors. We can also make sure that when we build infrastructure, we employ people and grow the economy. It's the best way to not only build a stronger country, but deliver growth and strength to our city and to our riding.
Thanks very much, Adam. We have Sharon Danley from the Green Party.
Hi, everyone. I'm enthused to be the Green Party candidate for my riding of Spadina-Fort York, and I thoroughly embrace Elizabeth May's mantra of working together across party lines. Politics is being in service to the people, which I've done for decades in my advocacy work. Whether streetcars or climate, Greens vote our constituency and our conscience. Canada is in trouble, and we need responsible, ethical leadership that puts people and the climate first. The world is in trouble with increased climate destruction, corporate infiltration, never-ending war, growing homelessness and climate refugees, women's violence, and much more that's born out of irresponsible governance. We're on the precipice, folks. We must honor our democratic responsibility and vote our conscience for a government that serves the people. We've run out of time. This election is the most important one in our history, and because of our climate, our well-being, and our grandchildren, they depend on what we do now.
Thanks, Sharon. Up next is Nick Lynn of the Marxist-Leninist Party.
In this election, the MLPC is calling on Canadians to be very active in defending their rights and standing up for those things they believe in. Canadians have been very active opposing Bill C-51, fighting for the rights of the First Nations, fighting to defend the environment, fighting for pension security, to defend the public post office and door-to-door mail delivery. We're asking for people to stand up and defeat the Harper government and its nation-wrecking. We're calling for a new direction for Canada's economy, one that upholds manufacturing, one that will build a self-reliant economy that keeps the wealth Canadians produce in Canada to fund our public services. We're also calling for Canada to have an anti-war government so that Canada is not involved in NATO, NORAD, and so on. We're also calling for Canadians to take up the work for democratic renewal and defeat the anti-democratic system that we have in Canada that deprives us of political power. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Nick. Up next, we have Michael Nicula, and he's from the Party of Accountability, Competency, and Transparency.
Thank you. My name is Michael Nicula. I'm 45 years old. I'm married. I have a daughter in university. I'm a CPA, a professional accountant, an architect as well. I have an MBA, and I own a small business in software development. I live and work in a district of Spadina-Fort York. My house is in tip-top building by the lake, and my office is in Chinatown on Spadina. Look, I'm not a politician. I am just a frustrated voter. I feel unrepresented and confused. I don't know what to vote anymore. 4 years ago, I voted for NDP. Olivia, my fellow candidate here, she quit the post. Now she wants it back. Then I voted NDP, but then the Liberal took the seat, and I'm not represented anymore. I envy those who have a very clear political color because they know what to vote. Like most Canadians, I'm all over the place. I'm conservative for economic issues. I'm liberal for human rights. And I'm here to change the political system, not just to change the color of the party in power.
Thank you very much, Michael. We will now begin our question and answer period of the debate. Now, each candidate will be given 30 seconds to respond, followed by an open discussion that we'll have as well. So we'll have our first question. In the wake of the 2008 recession, governments around the world went into deficits and they used public spending to stimulate the economy. Now, the government just announced that they have balanced the budget a year early. There is debate, though, as to whether or not our sluggish economy needs government stimulus. With the national debt set at about $612 billion right now, should we go back to deficits to see that debt rise, or do you support balancing the budget? We're going to start off with the Conservatives and Sabrina.
Thank you very much. Yes, the Conservatives have balanced the budget. The economy is growing. We have kept taxes low, and business revenues are up. We will continue to do this. We came out and said we had a plan. We stuck to the plan. We implemented the stimulus when it was needed. And now that the plan has been fulfilled, we will continue with a stable economy, keeping Canada moving forward and a strong government for this great country.
Okay, next we're over to Olivia from the NDP.
Well, the NDP believe that big corporations need to pay their fair share. because their taxes have been dropping the tax rate. And the both the Liberal and the Conservative government do not dare to ask the most rich and powerful, which is the big corporations, to pay their share. We will, though, because their rate have dropped so much. So we will ask them to pay their fair share, and because of that, we don't need to go and borrow money.
Okay, next, Adam.
Well, the federal government may or may not be in deficit, and we may or may not still be in a recession, but one thing is clear, is that you at home probably are in debt. And that's in large part because the federal government has downloaded to provinces, provinces to cities, and cities have downloaded to individuals. And if you're not carrying a student debt, you may be carrying a mortgage that you barely can pay. And if interest rates were to rise, that mortgage would become even more unaffordable. It's time for the federal government that has the capacity to spend, to invest to grow the economy, and to actually, if it has to, make strategic investments that may cause small deficit, modest deficits. But the goal here is to build the economy, build people's lives back, and have the federal government shoulder its responsibilities. We'll get that done.
We'll go next to Sharon.
Thank you. The Greens are going to raise the corporate tax to 19%, which is really reasonable. We have a lot of money that we can get that will help the economy. But when we get a balanced budget on the backs of the most vulnerable in society, like First Nations, veterans, etc., we have a real problem. That's not balancing the budget. That's out of balance altogether.
All right. Nick?
In terms of the balanced budget of the Conservative government, I mean, I like, you know, short fiction as much as anyone else, but that's really not the case. There's been all sorts of monkey business, Enron-style accounting that's presented a so-called balanced budget, which does not exist. In terms of what the Marxist-Leninist Party thinks, we need a fundamental reorganization of the economy. We need to stop paying the rich, paying corporations to come to Canada. We need to organize the economy so that the wealth that Canada produces is actually kept here to fund the social programs that we need.
All right, thanks very much, Michael. And Nick, rather, we're over to Michael next.
I'm going to put my CPA hat on, and I have to agree with the Conservatives on this one. The reason why Harper is still in power is because of his economic policies, not because of his human rights track. I believe that actually we should shift the budget from other priorities to more on the social assistance, more on healthcare, and most important on education, and close the tax loopholes. Taxes are fine the way they are. We just need to get rid of the tax evasion and tax avoidance.
Thanks very much, Michael. We're going to open the floor now to discussion on the economy itself. Adam, I'll start with
and
you.
Go ahead.
Olivia, you can go ahead.
I was picking up where Michael was talking about the loopholes.
Yes.
I agree, actually. Michael, there is a loophole. The CEO can take their loopholes in the stock options, and they end up not paying the taxes on their stocks. So we want to close that loophole. And from that, we managed to raise $500 million, which we would then take to lift children out of poverty so they won't go get to bed hungry. I think that's really, really important to do. Now, this doesn't impact on startups or small tech companies, only for big corporations, the big CEOs that are earning huge amount of money. They probably earn more in one day than a lot of us earn in a year.
If you're waiting for a streetcar, and you've been waiting and seen five go by like we see on King Street, and if you're waiting for housing repairs to happen, and if you're waiting for housing to be built, hearing the other parties say we're going to balance the budget first and get to those repairs afterwards, which is how back-end loaded programs work, and both the Conservatives and the NDP are proposing those, is just not fair. And so we have got to find a way to build the economy, build stronger cities, and in doing so, solve those problems while we grow the economy. That gives us the ability, with small, modest deficits in the first couple of years, to grow the economy and fold the revenues back into the government to balance the books. Just in the same way that students may borrow to get an education, to earn the money to pay off the debt and to support themselves later, or people borrow to buy a house, there's good debt and there's bad debt. And our debt to GDP ratio is so low, thanks to Liberal government policy, not thanks to the Conservatives that added $150 billion to the deficit in the last 8 years. But our debt ratio is in a position right now where we have to deal with the infrastructure deficit. It's the reason I left City Council. If you don't invest in cities, you're not investing in Canadians. And right now our cities are struggling. And if we don't make those changes, yeah, we'll balance the books, but we won't get a better country, and we won't deliver a better future to people, and we won't solve the urgent crisis that define the downtown of Toronto, and in fact, define downtowns right across the country. The time is now to act. A better country is possible, and a fairer country is possible.
Jump in. Go ahead. Go ahead, Sabrina.
I know Adam enjoys talking and talking so that the rest of us don't. He prefers that. The fact is that, as you mentioned, yes, we created a bit of a deficit to get out of a recession. There was a global recession in 2008, 2009. What happened under the Conservative government? Canada kept very stable throughout that. You did not see the huge changes in the way our economy functioned compared to other countries around the world. And I'll come back to another point that was made. The fact is that we have increased, and this was played out by journalists who are looking at all of the numbers. We've increased funding for Aboriginals, for seniors, and for our veterans.
Mm-hmm. Sharon, you
want to... One of the things that's missing on the balance sheet is a line for social capital. When we don't have social capital and we take care of everybody, and I mean take care of everybody so that nobody's in poverty, homeless, hungry, they can get their education, we're not a healthy country. We're not a healthy community, and that's not a healthy balance sheet.
It's this obsession with balancing the books. You know, you're obsessed
talking about it, actually.
No, but it's the goal here is to build a stronger and better country. And you can balance the books when you have a robust economy. The trouble with the Conservative policy over the last 8 years is that it's put us as the only G7 country into a recession. Three quarters of the debt that's been acquired since Confederation, is
we
responsibility.
Were never in a recession, and the latest numbers that have come out show a modest growth. So you can argue that. I know
the austerity programs of the Conservatives.
The latest was the
focus
Liberal
on
government
the balance
saying
budget,
that Stephen Harper cannot take credit for the growth
people.
Of our economy.
But can I just say that the Liberals are the ones that have supported the majority of Stephen Harper's budget, including the one in 2009. Had the Liberals have the guts to join the NDP as a coalition. We offered it. You walked away in 2009. You know, Stephen Harper wouldn't have been the prime minister for the last 6 years. So budget after budget,
the Liberals
voted in favor of it. Ours is a progressive budget. Hmm. We believe the best way is the middle way, is to say
that
we would...
But you've adopted Stephen Harper's way.
No, absolutely not.
The only difference is that you're raising corporate taxes and recklessly raising corporate taxes is a problem. It's a huge problem.
I'm going to actually have Michael respond, give him a chance. Go ahead, Michael.
Hard to finish a line.
The debt in this country is astonishing. The numbers, if you read, there's a website that shows the national debt as it grows second by second. And all this debt is on the shoulders of our children. And we cannot mortgage their future. Our students struggle with debt, and that's bad debt. So my daughter is in university now. She's lucky that I'm paying for her studies. But most of her students, most of her colleagues are gonna end their studies, and they will not be able to get married. They're not gonna get able to buy a house or anything like that. We are devastating the youth, the young generation of this country, and that has to stop. We have to actually diminish the debt, not to increase it.
Oil subsidies, there's a whole bunch of money there.
Just to pick up on the point Michael's raising about debt for students, for example, tuition's only been going up, and we also, students are also faced with the fact that under the Liberal government, ability for students to declare bankruptcy has been denied to them for 10 years after they graduate, which means that they're impoverished for that 10 years in order to pay off the loans that they have to take out from the banks just to pay off their education. In terms of this question of whether we're in a recession or not, I think that covering up the issue, what it covers up is the fact that public services have been wrecked by the Harper government in the name of neoliberal austerity. The social programs that people need are being either eliminated or privatized. manufacturing has been destroyed across the country. The Harper government refuses to hold companies that it lures here with massive subsidies. It refuses to hold them to account, to say that you have a responsibility to provide the jobs that you committed to, for the time you committed to ensure that Canadians have a good income, that they that the products that these companies produce that are needed by the Canadian economy are actually available to the Canadian economy, that we don't have to import these goods.
Mm-hmm. What Nick talked about the manufacturing industry losing jobs is 400,000 jobs lost. And what we're going to be seeing actually is going to be worse because of the recent signing of the Trans-Pacific Partnership, right? We are going to see a lot more manufacturing companies going down, especially in the auto parts, that would include the financial sector, the artistic sector. And that deal is now semi-public, and we are noticing, my gosh, there will be jobs that are going to be lost, and it's a deal that we really have trouble with.
Well,
and
the deal hasn't even been translated into English yet.
May I finish, please? We need to examine very carefully, and we should not give Stephen Harper a blank check.
The deal
and
hasn't
allow
been
them
released
to,
yet.
Of course, the details are out on the website. Okay.
Synopsises. There's suggestions that are contradicted by what's being released in Australia, in the United States, and in Canada. You've got the auto dealers and the
well,
auto
because
manufacturers.
Because the liberals can't decide whether to support
no,
it or not.
That's not what I've said.
We are saying that we will not.
The deal was negotiated in secret behind closed doors.
Exactly.
This was negotiated behind closed doors. All of the sectors that were involved.
Look, it's somewhere
just
between.
Just the fact that it was not negotiated in the media does not mean it was negotiated in silence.
Canadians were not informed. We were not empowered to decide on
what is the
content of this, and we're the ones who are going to have to bear the consequences of this sellout deal.
Somewhere between the Conservatives, who haven't released the text saying trust us, it's okay, and the NDP, who haven't seen the text saying trust us, we know it's bad. We've got to get the facts on the table. We have to bring it to Parliament and to the public, and we have to sit down as Canadians and we have to go through it. If the auto sector has 20,000 jobs put in peril, that's an issue Parliament must be seized of, and
right.
we have to solve that.
But wait a second, Adam. We are in an election.
Right.
The Liberals need to decide which side they're on. Okay.
No.
You can't be saying, we don't really know.
Facts.
We don't even know.
I don't depend on ideology to make the decision for me.
You never know where they stand.
No, I tell you exactly where I stand once I see the evidence.
You know where the NDP stands.
We have got to get back to looking at the facts first and deciding second.
With the government, you know what you're getting.
We're going to move on to that. We're going to move on to the next question now. And this has, you know, very specifically has to do with the riding itself and with a lot of growth within the riding of Spadina-Fort York. Increasing traffic congestion. We have crumbling expressways and overtaxed utilities, of course, lead critics to say that our urban infrastructure is not keeping up pace with the growth within the riding and the city itself. Massive infrastructure projects typically involve funding and cooperation between all three levels of government, of course. Parties have committed to funding for infrastructure, but when divided amongst the entire country's municipalities over a period of several years, the funding does fall short. What will you do to ensure Toronto, the largest municipality in Canada, gets its fair share? And I'm going to start with Olivia.
Mm-hmm. It's an excellent question because I've seen and I've experienced it myself that all the people in the good riding of Spadina, Fort York, being packed like sardines into streetcars, and then the streetcars get full and you can't even get on anymore. And meanwhile, it's raining or it's really cold. So NDP government will immediately inject $1.3 billion per year, which is total just in GTA alone, $12.9 billion over 20 years. That will buy new streetcars, new subways, and we can then plan ahead.
Okay, next to Adam.
Well, our plan is very clear, and it's so important that if we need to borrow to make it happen, we will do that because the infrastructure dollars must arrive. So the $60 billion program, which includes $20 billion for transit, $20 billion for housing and social infrastructure, $20 billion for green infrastructure and retrofitting of buildings, is aimed at land directly in cities. And if the money cannot be spent within a calendar year, the residual dollars flow straight back to cities directly through the gas tax. We top it up. the programs arrive through provincial negotiations and arrive on a per capita basis in our cities in a way that's fair across the entire country.
That's your 30
but
seconds.
That's the commitment the Liberals have made, and we will deliver on it come hell or high water.
Over to Sharon.
The Greens propose taking 1% of the GST, which is approximately $6.4 billion a year, and applying that to infrastructure. Also, a carbon tax and dividend plan. That's a fair bit of money, and we're going to put an army of skilled labor to work to get the job done so that it also creates jobs, and we want to work with renewables and smart planning and smart design for everybody.
Thanks very much, Nick.
On the question of funding for public infrastructure, I would, I guess, reiterate or build on some of the previous points I've made that there's often a question when it comes to public funding of infrastructure or social programs that there's a scarcity of resources, and so the point I want to reiterate is that the issue is that we don't have control over the economy. We don't have control over where the wealth that is produced in Canada is used. And when it comes to infrastructure, there's serious things to be aware of to oppose the use of P3s for public infrastructure, which leads to privatization.
Thanks very much. Over to Michael.
The cities have a lot that can be done to improve transit, not just to ask for more money. If you drive on Bathurst, at rush hour, you're going to see left turn allowed, right turn allowed. There's streetcar, that's the most stupid means of transportation still running in the city. And I think actually the solution in terms of financing the budget, it's an accounting solution. The cities and municipalities should get a portion of the income tax just like the provinces do.
Thanks very much, Michael. And next, Sabrina.
Thank you. I think we all agree that transit and getting around, especially in our riding of Spadina-Fort York, is a very difficult thing, and more money will come forth. Our government, Conservative government, has already invested records amounts of money in infrastructure, and at the same time, kept our taxes low, made sure that businesses can increase revenues. Because how do you get the money to support all of this? Not by going into debt for our grandchildren to pay for, but by increasing revenues.
All right, and I'll open the floor.
I find that the problem is not just not enough money, it's the way the money is being flown right now. Both the Conservatives and Liberals like to cut ribbons, and what they do is these one-off projects. It's like your boss coming to you with a nice big gift, which is okay, but you'd rather get your money every 2 weeks so you know how much you're getting, and that means that you can plan ahead. What the city all across Canada really needs is a stable, predictable funding, that are the funding that are from federal government being transferred to the cities by per capita, like by number of people living in the city or by ridership. In that way, then it'll be the experts that are making decisions.
Which is it, ridership?
Ridership, if it is gas tax, and if the other big portion of it, infrastructure, should be per capita. Transit, it should be by ridership, right? So the best way is to move ahead this way, then it's predictable, long-term, 20 years, and locked in for a national transit strategy. And that's the best plan I think the NDP has.
So it's one
I'm
point.
I'm going to go to Michael.
Just to build on what I was saying earlier, the accounting solution that I alluded to is close to what Olivia said. So basically, just like the provinces get a portion of your income tax. When you pay your taxes, CRA collects all the money and then sends 80% split between federal and provincial government. The city gets nothing. So it's very super simple. I work in payroll. It's very simple to build another, not increase taxes, let me be clear, not to increase the income tax, but to cut a portion from the income tax and should go directly to the cities and municipalities. Nobody should be tampering with that money, and nobody should be playing politics like Harper does. Oh, I'm going to give money to Calgary and not to Toronto because they voted Conservative.
Listen, so after seeing the city of Toronto go back and forth and back and forth and back and forth over plans for transit over the past as long as I've been here, 21 years, You think that the answer is to give money directly to the cities when they can't make up their mind?
Yes, just like give money to provinces and they mismanage funds,
the partnership with the provincial and municipal, they work together.
But your leader walked into Toronto, no conversation with the province, no conversation with city council, and put his arm around John Tory and said, smart track. In the same way that Tom Mulcair, when he was looking for seats in Scarborough, said, we're going to build Rob Ford's subway plan. Olivia, you have supported the subway plan at a town hall in Scarborough. You have supported David Miller's transit city plan when you ran for mayor. You have supported smart track as you walked out of the mayor's office with Andrew Cash. You have had more positions on transit than Toronto City Council has, and that's saying something. We both come out of the municipal sector. We know that steady, predictable funding is what has to happen. Mm-hmm. That's why our policy of $20 billion over 10 years for transit is just that. It arrives in equal installments each year. But you just said it would be $12 billion plus for Toronto over the next, and it will start with $1 billion next year, and it'll be over the next 20 years. If you do the math, that's half $1 billion each year for 20 years. Your money, like the Conservative money, is back-end loaded. In your two-page costing document, it shows that. That's not steady, predictable funding. That's playing politics. And as Tom Mulcair embraces the Scarborough subway, and you get Rob Ford's endorsement, and as you stand there and take different positions every time you're under a different level of office, you are the one who are chasing ribbon-cutting exercises.
Hang on a second. You can't just make things up.
I'm not.
Just at what point have I actually said that I'm picking this project or that project?
When you ran for mayor, when you were a member of parliament, you chose Rob Ford's subway plan.
At some point, you need to allow other people doesn't mean that you are right, okay? You have to look at my track record. It's the National Transit Strategy, which your party has agreed with. The National Transit Strategy,
you love transit. Love transit. Big deal.
Adam, stop interrupting everybody? Can we actually allow each other to finish a sentence? Is that too much to ask?
No.
So we have been saying very clearly for a long time, if you've been paying attention, is that we believe, the NDP believe through a national transit strategy, that it really should be per ridership or by capita. And if you recall, in 2006 and 2004, there was a budget, that the Paul Martin and Jack Layton budget, and that budget said very clearly that the money, it was going to go to $4.6 billion. It was going to go to a tax cut. This is what for big corporations. This is what Paul Martin wanted. Jack Layton at the time said, no, let us invest in public transit, in affordable housing, and all of those things, and actually added 1 cent of gas tax. Rather than picking and choosing projects, we got the right, you know how the funding was transferred? It was transferred by ridership. Okay, Adam, I don't know whether you understood that.
Of course
it was transferred by ridership. We did not pick projects.
That was 10 years
and
ago.
The Liberals, in 13 years in government, always pick and choose projects. David Collinette,
hear the Green Parties talk about this.
You know, you have picked and choose projects.
Sharon,
we will not do that.
If you can add?
Well, one of the things I would add is wherever the money comes from and whenever it comes, that we need more transparency and accountability about how that money is funded, who it's going to, how it's being spent. That's something that's a huge problem across the board.
And Nick, do you want anything to say on this?
Sure. I mean, just to develop on my initial response, the question with a lot of public projects nowadays is, the question of funding is that a lot of projects are being done on the basis of a public-private partnership, which is a way for private companies to get their foot in the door to begin privatizing what should be strictly public infrastructure. So that's something to be very aware of. It's already been happening in the healthcare sector, other sectors as well. And I mean, as for transit, I mean, one of the big problems is constant underfunding of public services to put them in a crisis situation, so that the discussion becomes, do we increase fares or do we cut back services, rather than the point being that there's a certain level of funding that's needed to be provided to public services in order them to do the job they're required.
Okay, we're gonna move on to our next question. It's about affordable housing. So affordable housing and homelessness, it is a top concern, of course, for many in the riding. Do you feel that there is a need for a national housing strategy throughout Canada? And I'm gonna start with Adam.
Yes. We have the remnants of a program. We have about $2.5 billion being currently spent at the federal level, if you include Aboriginal First Nations communities on reserve. It's not enough. And the reason I got into politics and left journalism was to build housing, to do it in the city in the absence of a strong federal program and provincial investments. But I also left city council and joined the Liberal Party to write the national housing program. $20 billion, including investments in social infrastructure. So we don't just build apartments, we build complete communities that let people succeed. Right. Is part of that commitment.
Thanks.
But there are other programs attached to that, because it's not just public housing, it's the full spectrum of housing that needs
and
to be approached.
And we'll move on to Sharon.
Yes, the Greens are developing a national housing strategy or plan, and we really believe in working together. Adam has put a lot of work into housing. We've talked before, we will talk after. We want to work together. Every Canadian deserves a home. Every single Canadian. There's no need for homelessness, there's no need for poverty, there's no need for any of this. What we need is to plan better and spend smarter.
Okay, Nick.
Housing is a right, and that's, so the question is, how are we gonna organize the economy to actually see that that right is met and not have it be an up in the air policy objective? And I think, what we're seeing in Canada is that people are fighting for the right to housing, but they're being denied the control over the economy to actually exercise that right. So that's what I'll say for now.
All right, Michael.
Yeah, I will side with the Conservatives again on this one. I think the social assistance programs don't have to go into micromanaging somebody's life. Yes, we have to make sure that we eliminate poverty, so we have to put a safety net underneath. But then how people spend their money, it's up to them. So I support just the social assistance money that go in, and we have plenty of programs already in, and that's about it.
Okay, Sabrina.
Thank you. Yes, we have a very strong plan to get at least 700,000 individuals and families into homes. The fact is that our Conservative government spends at least $1.7 billion each year for social housing across the country. In the stimulus plan, we put together $2 billion to build and renovate housing. This is very much what we have done since 2006. We have a record of spending $17.2 billion.
All right, Olivia. Mm-hmm.
The situation is really desperate. There is 90,000 households waiting desperately for housing, some of them seniors and kids. And the NDP has a national housing strategy. Unfortunately, the Conservatives voted against it. And 20 years ago, we lost the national housing program because of the former Liberal government canceling it. We will immediately build 10,000 units of affordable housing, and then also spent $2.1 billion to fix the housing that's falling down right now, and built new ones too.
Okay, and we'll open it up to discussion. Did you want to respond first off, Sabrina?
Well, I'll say first, going back, the idea of creating a huge government bureaucracy to deal with this issue that is a municipal issue is just the wrong way to go. Like I said, quoted the numbers that we have, everybody likes to throw out numbers. This is what actually gets to the people who need the help. So that's our strategy, that's our plan. We also put together a strong plan for TFSAs. 11 million individuals in Canada, we have a country of what, about 33 million? 11 million people use TFSAs, have invested in that. We also have a strong plan for increasing the home buyers plan for RRSPs. So there are a number of different options to make sure that individuals can buy a home. And the number one most important way to make sure individuals can afford a home is through having jobs. Through having a strong economy, we will continue to build jobs, create jobs. This is what our small businesses do. This is what our large businesses do. And this is the plan that we support.
The conservative plan is a plan not to have a plan.
Sabrina, you don't need to create a new bureaucracy.
No,
because CMHC is already there.
Yeah.
In the 70s and 80s, they built a lot of affordable housing. And the mandate have changed. In the 90s, they said, well, you can't, you know, not there to really do much housing anymore. It has a $5 billion reserve fund. They're not even using it. So CMHC is there to build affordable housing if you choose to have it. And I think we should really give that mandate back to CMHC, renew the co-op agreements. And in our riding, there are at least 21 big TCHC buildings, there's a good number of co-ops, and they
and
need the support.
TCHC renovates their own offices.
Look, you can blame the cities all you want, but the reality is this. There is a housing program that's still in place in Ottawa. It is not strong enough. We do need to renew the agreements that have never been canceled. We need to make sure that we start investing in it. But we also have another problem in the riding, one that we don't like to talk about, and that's this. There's a housing bubble. Speculation has created that. And there are people living in this riding that have bought their first condominium. And if the housing market were to suddenly correct, equity would be lost. And one of the only mechanisms left to the federal government to fix that problem is to boost interest rates, which would see your mortgage rates double very quickly. We're at the brink of creating a crisis in the private sector while we haven't addressed the one in the public sector. So the Liberals plan not just the $20 billion investment to build and renew the agreements and start getting the federal government back into a position where it leads the housing conversation, but we also have to take a look at rental housing, private purpose-built rental housing. Stimulate that. It doesn't cost a lot of money. We can help by allowing the government's balance sheets to be borrowed against to fund that kind of construction. And that may be just enough to solve housing crisis in some other parts of the country where it's not affordability but simply supply of rental housing. We also need to make sure first-time home buyers have a road to purchasing. These are an array of programs that do more than just simply cost money. They build cities. They build economies. They put people to work. I've done it in Alex Park. We can solve problems with housing rather than constantly call it a crisis. And that's the difference in the Liberal platform that I've had the privilege of putting together.
Will let Michael respond?
I agree with service. I don't want the government to build any houses. The government is the worst project manager in the history of management. What I want to see is more money put in the same programs that we have currently in place. And I'm going to give Mr. Harper a tip. The budget was quoted $1.7 billion into housing. Well, how about stop wasting money on those stupid Canada's Economic Actions Plan ads, which amount to $700 million.
All in favor?
Yes.
Okay. And that will increase the housing budget by 50%. 50%. I don't want to see those ads anymore. Please. Please.
Sharon, I'll let you respond.
One of the things that I agree with Adam, what he's saying about the whole spectrum. But some of the things that we don't talk about are the needs of the disability community. And the older demographic is going to become less able-bodied. So we need to make plans for those sorts of things. The whole question of shelters needs to be massively revisited. It is not working. And co-ops are great when they work well, and when they don't, they're horrid. We have to have a real cleanup of what's going on in the co-op sector. And when the money comes down, who administers it? Again, a bureaucratic question.
Okay. Well, I actually have a... Oh, sorry, Nick.
Just to address some of the points that have come up, I mean, this question of housing and people's income, I mean, we have a situation where people, because of the massive number of job losses under the conservative dictatorship, people are actually losing their houses. So, you can talk all you like about housing programs and so on, but if you're destroying the economy by allowing companies to move manufacturing outside of Canada, if you're not working to strengthen Canada's economy, then ensure that people have the jobs that will permit them to get housing, then how are you really addressing this question?
I'm going to move on to the next question now.
It is about Bill C-51. It was recently passed by the legislature. It's a new anti-terror legislation that makes significant changes to national security measures that we know right now. Among other things, it facilitates information sharing among federal institutions, gives police preventative detention powers, it bans the promotion of terrorism, and it enhances the powers of CSIS as well. The Liberals supported the bill and the NDP opposed it. What is your stance on Bill C-51? And I'm going to start with Sharon.
Simply, we oppose it. We would repeal it. End of story.
Okay. Nick?
Bill C-51 should absolutely and completely be repealed. It's incredible the sort of expanded police powers it gives to CSIS and the RCMP to violate Canadians' rights, supposedly in the name of upholding security. So it's literally, it's a contradiction. And already, even before C-51 came in, we've seen how state agencies, state violence is used against protesters. And this will just expand those powers and give them greater abilities to violate people's rights.
Michael.
PACT, the party I represent, is the online party of Canada. It promotes online voting. And I truly believe that Canadians should have a direct say in any issues related to human rights. We should not let the politicians to decide for us, because there are cases in legalizing a lot of things, marijuana, prostitution, euthanasia, Bill 51, where the government actually is on the minority in when it comes to public opinion. And if we put all these issues online, Canadians can vote and do whatever they want.
Sabrina?
Yes, as the Conservative candidate, yes, we support Bill C-51, as you mentioned. It allows different levels of security forces to be able to talk to one another, to share information, to make sure the full spectrum of activities that could endanger our lives, they are taking care of that. I trust CSIS. This thought that somehow CSIS is a scary or any of the other security forces are scared, no. It's the terrorists that are the scary ones, not the security forces.
Yeah. Olivia?
Canadians don't want government to listen to their cell phones or peering into their internet search history. And we have a right to privacy. And this C-51 is dangerous, is reckless, is ineffective. Amnesty International called it that it would make us even more at risk. And it's very disappointing that the Liberals voted together with the Conservative and didn't take a principled stand against it. We will absolutely repeal it, because fear and division have no place in this country of ours. Let's replace it with hope and optimism.
Adam.
Somewhere between the fear of a spy being in every wall and the fear of a terrorist being under every rock, we have to manage public safety and the public's charter rights. Bill C-51 touched 64 different pieces of legislation, and some of it was necessary to protect public safety. Some of it needed to be changed. We worked hard in parliamentary committee to make that happen. Unfortunately, we didn't get the support of the NDP for things like stronger civilian oversight or a sunset clause or even sending it off to be tested against the Constitution before it came back to Parliament for final reading. We will fix the parts that are broken, and we need to do that.
Right.
But we can't pretend, and we have to stop pretending, that the fear on the one side, the fear on the other side yeah. is somehow balanced out by doing nothing. Well,
thank you, Adam. We're going to open the floor now to Bill C-51 and your thoughts on your fellow candidates' responses.
Well, actually, Bill C-51 does not mandate CSIS to share information to RCMP, with RCMP. And five former prime minister and former chief justice all said that this is a terrible bill. And originally, when the bill first came forward, a lot of people supported it, and because they haven't even read the bill very carefully, and they were just bullied into those. They were very fearful. And then they read it and thought, my God, let's not do this. So instead of fearing our neighbors, we should support each other. Let us repeal the entire bill.
There's nothing in it that's worth saving.
But your leader has already said he's going to bring provisions of it back. For example, when he talked about the no-fly list, which is one of the elements that we supported, we had a number of young people going over to Syria, joining into a civil war, while Canadian peacekeepers were on the ground, and you had a situation with Canadians firing literally at other Canadians, generating a refugee crisis, the likes of which we still haven't found a proper solution
to. Those aren't peacekeepers.
And so Tom Mulcair said he'll bring that back to protect falling states or failed states from having mercenaries join them. I think it's a good part of the bill. I don't think all of the bill is good. But when you're presented with an omnibus bill, you've got to take a balance between public safety and the public charter rights. We know the charter is still in existence. Omar Khadr got his bail and got his bail conditions relaxed, even with C-51. You'd be hard-pressed to tell me someone who's been spied on or someone who's been arrested under C-51. Okay,
well, I'm going to get Nick to Maha Arar would still be in jail. Maha Arar was renditioned in Syria. His lawyer, Lorne Wardman, said that if C-51 is in place at the time, he would probably still be in
prison. Olivia, you get more debate than we do. Let us talk, please. Let us talk.
Michael, go ahead.
Yeah, so I really don't care what Amnesty International says about it. I don't care what Stephen Harper says about it. I don't care what Justin Trudeau says about it. I care about what I think about it and what you think about it and all the other voters, because this is what matters. Okay, now this bill, it's a huge bill. You can't say everything is bad or everything is good about it. It should be broken down on individual issues. And all those individual issues should be put online where I and you and everybody else can say, yes, I want this. I want sissies to listen to my phone conversation because they may catch a terrorist, or maybe I don't. But let me make that decision, not Amnesty International, not Justin Trudeau, and not Harper.
Sharon, Nick, do you want to jump in?
Sure. I mean, just to touch on that point, I mean, it's a fundamental one of the anti-democratic aspects of the Harper dictatorship is its use of omnibus bills to actually prevent people from being able to properly discuss the kinds of massive changes it's bringing in. In terms of Bill C-51, this is a whole bogus argument that's being made in terms of what constitutes security for Canadians. Canadians' primary concern about security is about income security. It's about security for their pensions, that people want a stable and predictable livelihood, that they want health care, that they want education, that they don't want to go into debt to pay for these things. In terms of so-called terrorist threats, I mean, the Harper government has had to, or the security agencies have had to go out of their way to set up patsies, sting operations for people who on their own wouldn't be able to, you know, hurt someone, you know, with anything. So this is the sort of setup we're facing. And Bill C-51 and other anti-terrorist acts, one of the things they talk about is economic disruptions to Canada. And what that is, it's a code word for going after the workers when they go on strike to defend their rights.
In all due respect, I was at Nathan Cirilla's funeral. I was on Parliament Hill when that happened. Those were real incidents, and real people and real Canadians were hurt by it. I support you in what you say about the need to deal with poverty and the atrocious violation of civil rights that poverty brings to Canadians, including and most importantly First Nations. But we have got to be real about things that are real. What happened on Parliament Hill, I was there. What happened to Patrice Vincent, that individual, was detained by the RCMP, and the threshold for detention was too high.
What does that have to do with C-51, may I ask?
Because preventive detention measures were modified so that they could have conditioned his release.
They would have caught
the person? They had him 2 days earlier.
If C-51 had been in place...
They had him 2 days earlier.
I thought that man was mentally disturbed.
We don't know about that.
So I think Canada should stop bombing Syria and Iraq and other places and go back to peacemaking and peacekeeping, okay?
And then
people will stop hating us the way they do today. I went to Iran 2 months ago. I was afraid to say I'm Canadian because I was in a house, an Iranian man told me that his enemy is United States, Canada, and Israel, and he wants to kill us.
Okay. I'm going to give the last word to Sharon, just so that Sharon can respond.
I agree that what we need to get back to is the peacekeepers that the world has known and loved us by. And I really think that most Canadians identify ourselves as peacekeepers, not warmongers. And when you take care of poverty and education and health care and homes, when all those things are in place, we're spending our time on the things we need to be spending it on, not this other stuff.
Okay, thank you very much. And it's time now for our closing statement. We're going to do this in the reverse order from our opening statement. And once again, just a reminder, you get 30 seconds per person. So we're going to start off with Michael.
I want to speak directly to those who feel unrepresented, those who don't know what to vote for, those who don't vote at all. There are 40% of Canadians who don't vote at all. Young people, I am your best bet. Don't waste your vote on a party that in 4 years from now, guaranteed most of you, 80% of you, are going to try to vote them out of the government. No matter who you choose, in 4 years, you're going to try to vote them out. Be honest, cast a positive vote, vote for what you want, not against what you don't like.
Thank you very much. Over to Nicklin.
So, to reiterate, the Marxist-Leninist Party is calling for a new direction for Canada's economy. We're calling for a program of democratic renewal to empower Canadians to actually be the decision makers over all the affairs that concern them in Canada. And we're also calling for Canada to have an anti-war government, for it to get out of NATO, NORAD, to end its involvement in U.S. wars of aggression. Visit us online at mlpc.ca.
Thank you very much, Sharon Danley.
Thank you for the invitation to participate. Greens are keen to clean up the mess in Ottawa, to repeal outrageous laws, create a sustainable green economy, move people out of poverty into health and well-being, and bring back parliamentary decorum. We have an opportunity to turn things around with this election and to reclaim the peacekeeping, beautiful Canada we all love. So please, remember to vote. It may be the most important thing you do this year.
Thanks very much, and over to Adam Vaughan.
I keep going through the NDP platform, and I look for this time machine that they want to build to go back and prosecute budgets that were passed before my daughter was born, my daughter who's now in university. I look at the conservative costing machine, and I can't see a solution to the problems that are plaguing us in Toronto and in this country. I don't see growth, and I don't see a better opportunity on the horizon. We can build a better Canada. We can build a fairer Canada. You can be part of that. On October 19th, we need your vote to elect a Liberal government to transform this city, this riding, and this country.
Thanks very much, and over to Olivia Chow.
Hello, neighbors. Thank you for your past support in the last 8 years as your Member of Parliament. I would take the experience that I have and add it to Tom O'Care's leadership quality and repair the damage Stephen Harper has inflicted upon us. Let's do it together on October 19th. Let us create a much better Canada together.
All right, thanks very much, Olivia. And last but not least, Sabrina Zuniga.
Thank you. Tonight you've seen very different versions and visions of Canada's future. For the fear-mongering for Stephen Harper, this is just simply untrue. What we don't need is high debt or high taxes. That's why stick with the Prime Minister you know is going to be stable, that is going to grow our economy, that you can trust, you know where we're going to go, you know that vote for me as your MP and I will represent you well in Spadina Fort York.
Thank you very much, Sabrina. Thank you to all the candidates for joining us tonight for the debate. And thank you all for joining us on the local campaign. Airtimes for other debates can be found on rottv.com. I'm Tammy Sutherland. Bye for now.